I'm Amanda Clark. I'm president of the Seattle King County League, and I want to thank all of you for coming to this forum, which I think will be a very fascinating and maybe confusing forum. I mean, this is a really deep topic. I'd also like to thank the panelists who will talk to you and our moderator, Ellen Barton, and Ellen will be introducing the panelists to you. I want to thank Betty Sullivan, who's our trusty baker who makes the cookies for us. Also, if you're not a member and you might be interested in more information about the league, you can see our membership chair, Panine Davidson. Panine, would you just, you can go see her afterwards. And you may have noticed in the back that we have a jar where we've asked for some voluntary donations to help us defray the costs of these forums. We actually pay about $4,000 a year to do this. So if you can, you know, if you like, you know, we'd be very grateful for any donation that you can make. So one other announcement, there's a legislative action workshop on November 21st, and it's the theme is working toward progressive taxation. This one's going to be in Bellevue at St. Andrew's Church. It's very easy to get to, right off I-90. And if you need a ride, there are some of us who will be happy to take you, I think. So you can sign up, from our website. And I think, from the state website? Okay, from the state website. And I believe it does cost $25, but it includes lunch. So I hope to see you there. So with that, I would like to introduce Ellen, who is our immediate past president, an experienced moderator of these panels, and she will take it from here. Ellen Barton.
Thank you. The way we're going to do this is each speaker is going to have 20 minutes to talk to us first, and then we'll open it up to questions from the floor. So you saw those index cards, and what we'd like you to do is write your questions on there and hold them up, and hopefully someone will come and get them. Janet, wherever she went. Someone will come and get them, or you can just wave them until I come and get them. But anyway. So let me start. I think what I was told is that we're just going to go ahead and go one by one. So first I'll, I'll introduce our first speaker, who is Paul Lawrence. He's the senior litigation partner at Pacifica Law Group. He concentrates his practice on complex appellate and civil litigation, including commercial, municipal, constitutional, environmental, and insurance coverage cases in federal and state courts. Paul's appellate experience includes over 50 appeals, principally in the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals, the Supreme Courts of both Washington and Montana, and in the Washington State Court of Appeals. He has also argued cases before the United States Supreme Court, the 3rd, 11th D.C. Federal Circuit Courts of Appeal, as well as the California and New York appellate courts. Mr. Lawrence represented the League of Women Voters of Washington in the challenge of the charter school system, which was set up by initiative and was decided in the challenger's favor, as you guys probably know, in September of 2015. He will also be working on the challenge to the latest IMIN initiative that looks like passed. So he's a very important person, and he's going to talk to us now about constitutional amendments.
Thank you for that introduction. That's very kind. First of all, I want to apologize if my voice is a little bit scratchy. I'm at the end of a cold, which I think a lot of people have had. So let me know if you have any problem hearing me. It sounds like it's pretty good amplification. I was going to start with a little bit of just discussion about the process of amending the Constitution and how it has been used in the past 200 some odd years. And a little bit of trivia, and then sort of discuss a little bit about the pros and cons of amending the Constitution. Sure. So the process for amending the U.S. Constitution is actually, it's a really difficult process and with a really high standard. It's a two-part process. There's a proposal process in which amendments are proposed, and then a ratification process that takes the amendments that are proposed and puts them to a ratification vote. There are two methods set forth in the Constitution for proposing amendments. The first is that can be proposed by a two-thirds vote of each House of Congress. So that is the Senate and the House separately have to have supermajorities to propose an amendment. There is also in the Constitution the possibility of a constitutional convention that's called by Congress on application of the legislatures of two-thirds of the state, but that constitutional convention process has never been invoked in the history of the United States. So the only way that amendments have ever been proposed is through this two-thirds vote of each House of Congress. Now the ratification process, if something is proposed, and let's say, so in the history, actually there have been over 11,600 amendments that have been proposed in each House, or in the House or the Senate. But of those 11,600 and some odd, only 33 have received the two-thirds majority in each House to send them on to the state. Again, that tells you how difficult it is, you know, culling down from 11,600 to 33. And we know that 10 of those 33 are the Bill of Rights. So thinking beyond that, it's a very small number. Now, the ratification process is also very difficult. Each proposal that comes out of the Congress has to be adopted by the legislatures of three-fourths of the states. Again, so this is a really heightened supermajority requirement. It is also possible, alternatively, for there to be ratifying conventions in each of the states, and again, it's a three-fourths requirement of those ratifying conventions, and I think Congress gets to decide which route, whether it goes to state legislatures or through ratifying conventions. I think it's important to note that there's not any process involved in the constitutional amendment that involves, at any stage, a direct vote by the people. So there's no process for the people to vote on an amendment, either proposing it or ratifying it. So as I indicated, there have been 33 amendments that have come out of Congress that have been proposed. Of those 33, 27 were adopted. And a little trivia from this process is, what is the shortest period of time that an amendment has taken from proposal to ratification? Is actually the second to last amendment we've had, which was the right of people to vote at 18, which took only 3 months and 8 days. The longest one is the one that was most recently passed, the 27th Amendment, which took 202 years, 7 months and 12 days. Just as an anecdotally, James Madison originally proposed 19 amendments that were whittled down in Congress to 12 that were the original 12 amendments that were proposed, 10 of which became the Bill of Rights. This one that was enacted, the latest amendment, was one of the 12. And apparently some student figured out that it was still a live amendment and made an effort to get it passed, and it was actually ratified then 202 years after its enactment. The subject is not all that exciting. It basically says that Congress cannot adopt a raise in pay for their own Congress. It only goes into effect in the next Congress. But that was the 27th Amendment and took 202 years in the making. The general subjects of the amendments have been somewhat limited. I think most famous, obviously, we know the Bill of Rights, and that obviously has been very important amendments. They're sort of fundamental to what we think of as our government. They are rights that were given generally to individuals, and rights that really were demanded by the states as a bargain for agreeing to ratify the U.S. Constitution. And that includes free speech rights, which are at the heart of at least this Supreme Court's interpretation of Citizens United. There are other sets of amendments that are that probably are less sexy, so to speak. The 11th Amendment had to do with sovereign immunity of the states. Now, that may be of interest to us only because it is one of five proposed amendments that were in response or at least sought to overturn or change a United States Supreme Court decision. So there is a history in the amendment process of using the amendment process to overturn a Supreme Court decision. The 11th Amendment, which had to do with sovereign immunity of states, the U.S. Supreme Court indicated there was not sovereign immunity within the federal court system. And as a result of that decision, there was an amendment proposed and passed that granted essentially sovereign immunity to the states within the federal court jurisdiction. It took the jurisdiction out of the federal courts of disputes against the states unless a state voluntarily agreed to participate. There have been a number of amendments that sort of deal with particularities of presidents, senators, members of Congress, terms, how they're elected. For example, the amendment that limits presidents to two terms, amendments that have allowed for the direct election of senators. They used to be elected through the state legislatures. And again, an interesting note, because I know that a lot of this is being driven by Citizens United, a lot of the rationale for the adoption of the amendment allowing direct election by the people of senators was in response to the fact that there was a great deal of bribery that used to go on within state legislatures in order to identify people who would be elected senator. I mean, and the, one of the most interesting and egregious, if you ever want to read history, is you should read about the history of the state of Montana, where you had the two barons of the major mining operations in the state vying to pay off various members of the state legislature in order to be appointed to the Senate. Fascinating history, if you want to go there. There were obviously the Civil War amendments, 13th, 14th, and 15th amendments, which obviously are extremely important and extremely significant in changing the country. But in terms of the question about how amendments are adopted, when amendments should be adopted, I think it's important to recognize that those amendments basically were adopted as a result of the end of a war, as a part of the end of the war. In other words, the southern states were required to adopt the amendments and support the amendments as a condition to their re-entry into the Union after the war. So it was a little bit of a unique process to get the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments adopted, not traditional, and although it, certainly Citizens United is worth fighting about, hopefully we won't have a civil war over it. The 16th Amendment dealing with income tax is another example of a amendment that was adopted after a Supreme Court case. There had been various federal types of income taxes that had started, I think, going back to the Civil War. In the late 1890s, a case got to the U.S. Supreme Court, and the U.S. Supreme Court said that income taxes were not consistent with the U.S. Constitution, and as a result of that, about 20 years later, there was an amendment that allowed the federal income tax to be adopted. Two of the amendments, as you know, dealt with prohibition, one imposing, one taking off the prohibition, so those kind of negate each other. So two of the 27 are really kind of a nothing. And then sort of the last sort of set of amendments had to do with voting rights, which I think were very important amendments. They're the more recent amendments, but as you know from this organization, the 19th Amendment granting the right of women to vote. You had rights to 18-year-olds, which we talked about. We also have rights that prohibited a poll tax as a condition to voting. So those are, you know, in general, the type of amendments that that have been adopted. In terms of the six that have not been adopted, they're not very exciting. One of them is obviously the Equal Rights Amendment, which I know that you're all very excited about. But besides that, the only one that dealt with a response to a Supreme Court case was an unratified amendment dealing with the child labor laws. There was a Supreme Court case that had struck down child labor laws on a national level. It was sort of in the pre-Roosevelt, I won't say packing of the court, but there were a series of decisions in the 20s and early 30s that sort of rejected the notion of federal regulation of labor. And those, in particular, that decision was effectively overturned by a later court that upheld the Fair Labor Standards Act, which included provisions regulating child labor. So that the momentum for that that amendment failed. There are still a couple of pending amendments. Unfortunately, the Equal Rights is not one of them. The Equal Rights Amendment and the District of Columbia Voting Rights Amendments both came with ratification periods attached to them, and obviously those periods have passed. If one wants to do a civic project, there are in fact still some pending amendments out there if you want to try to work on them. One would strip citizenship from United States citizens who accepts a title of nobility from a foreign country. So it is a really hard process, and even as compared to like the Washington State Constitution, it's a more difficult process. For our state constitution, you do need to start in the legislature. It has the same sort of supermajority requirement that each the Senate and the House, it's two-thirds of each, have to propose a constitutional amendment, but then it goes to a vote of the people, and it's a straight majority vote of the people of the state of Washington if they want to adopt an amendment that comes out of the state legislature. Now, in terms of when and how and if one should support general notions of a constitutional amendment, It's a difficult question. I think the history of these amendments suggests that it's an extremely hard process. And, you know, to be frank about it, even to consider having an amendment that might amend Citizens United is a real long shot. I mean, you have to get it through Congress with two-thirds. They can't do anything with the majority. That doesn't mean that you shouldn't support it or try, but you know, realistically, it's a very difficult proposition. In thinking about it more broadly, not that this is a be-all and end-all of it, but one person who is in favor of making it easier to amend the Constitution is Justice Antonin Scalia. That gives me pause. Anything that he says gives me pause. And his view is that, as you know, his view is you have a very static constitution and the original intent in terms of trying to interpret the language of the constitution. And so if you have a static constitution, in order to keep it current, you need to have an easier process for amending the constitution in order to bring it into whatever terms people want in current day. The great fear that I have about an overly easy amendment process is the potential for populist abuse. And populism, populism is generally a good thing, but in my mind, what the Bill of Rights does and a lot of what the Constitution does, I mean, the Constitution does two things. It provides protections against the abuse of power by the federal government, and it provides protection particularly against minority parts of our community. And that's, you know, particularly the Bill of Rights. And one of the things we saw over the last 20 years, you know, particularly starting in 1994 when Hawaii adopted gay marriage in their state originally, was a sweeping across the country, particularly across conservative parts of the country, adopting either laws, but in many cases constitutional provisions that prohibited or limited marriage to a man and a woman. Now in Washington State, we adopted a statute. We do not allow a constitutional amendment by initiative or by any sort of that public vote, but in many states, there were constitutional amendments adopted, you know, limiting marriage to a man and a woman. And, you know, I think that has to give one pause about how you should use the amendment process, because it is equally misused, in my mind, as equally well used in others. I think that you have to consider Another issue that is possibly subject to as much controversy as Citizens United is abortion rights. And there's, you know, would you want to support or take a policy stand that would support the process of amending or making it easier, supporting using the amendment process to change that kind of decision? I don't think the League would obviously support the substance of that decision. But in thinking about how to draw a line between an amendment that would change Roe v. Wade versus an amendment that would change Citizens United, it's hard to draw a principled line that's not really vested in the particular amendment. The point being that it is in my mind something that should be rarely done and has been rarely done. When you're thinking about how it affects what you do in a court before a court of law, when you're dealing with a constitutional provision, you do get into a situation where you are on one hand arguing the meaning of constitutional terms from the time it was adopted, and the same thing with respect to statute. To seg into the charter school case, a lot of reason why the charter school case was successful is because there was a lot of history about the state constitutional provisions dealing with public education and some very early on state Supreme Court decisions interpreting that language that really made it, in my mind, clear that charter schools as structured in the initiative were not constitutional, and that's what the Supreme Court has held so far. But that was based really on the history of the provisions of the state constitution and some early history around the interpretation. So you are always arguing whether it's as a matter of what the constitution means or what a statute means. You're arguing what did the founding fathers and mothers mean when they adopted the constitution at the time they adopted the constitution. And obviously there's some guidance to that because you look to what history there was, you look to what people wrote about at the time, you might look to what people said at the time, which can be very powerful. And like I said, it was very effective in the charter school case, but in the hands of certain justices who believe in original intent, like Scalia, it can be very limiting in terms of how you interpret a constitutional provision.
Let me just... interject here. I think let's move on to Alice,
sure.
And there may be some more questions that you can then elaborate on some of the things you'd like to say.
Absolutely. Thank you.
So Alice Woldt is the executive director of Fixed Democracy First, formerly known as Washington Public Campaigns. She's been a leader of WAmend, a coalition supporting an amendment to the U.S. Constitution that would overturn Supreme Court decisions that have allowed unlimited expenditures by corporations and others on elections. She is on the executive committee of Honest Elections Seattle and was active on the Fair Elections Seattle campaign in 2013 and the recently passed Seattle Public Financing Initiative, too. As the former co-director of Faith Action Network and executive director of the Washington Association of Churches and the Church Council of Greater Seattle, she brings a long history of leadership and organizing in the peace and justice, faith, and political communities. Let's give a warm welcome to Alice Woldt.
Thank you, and a big thank you to the League of Women Voters and all of the support that you gave to Honest Elections Seattle. Maybe in Seattle we're getting democracy back on track here. And especially to Amanda, who was featured in the TV ads and on the mailers and so on. You know, the League is a really trusted messenger. And it's been a privilege for Fixed Democracy First to work in partnership with the League on a number of issues, efforts to achieve public financing being one of them, but also working on disclosure laws, supporting and improving the Public Disclosure Commission. There are just a few of those issues that we've worked together on. And I'm hopeful that a constitutional amendment will be another successful partnership. You know, a lot of people think, well, it's really crazy to try to get a constitutional amendment passed, including, I think, my partner on the panel here to the left.
Crazy.
But we think that given since Citizens United was, the decision was made by the Supreme Court, there has been a lot of attention made to what is happening to democracy in this country. And I just want to mention that a year ago, E.J. Dionne, who writes regularly, is a column in the Seattle Times, said in his column, "Are we spending our democracy into oblivion?" $2 billion was spent on attack ads in the 2012 election, and the money spent in 2014 didn't slow down, and I can't imagine what it's going to be like in 2016. We may not see too much of that money in Washington State because we are considered a blue state, so we're written off pretty much. But in the states where there is a more even division between the parties, I can't imagine. It's already started. The Koch brothers and, of course, Trump and the money that he has and all of the money that is going into the super PACs is an abomination for a democracy. So, you know, the other thing that E.J. Dionne said in the same column is that the money is driving the partnership that has crippled the U.S. Congress, and it is trickling down to the state and local levels as well. So it is a serious issue. And people believe that it's a serious issue. 96% of people who have been polled think that it's important to reduce the influence of money in politics. 95% believe that it's important to reduce that the influence of money is a very serious problem in government and in our legislative arenas. 91%, the influence of campaign contributions on congressional actions is a serious problem. And 77% believe that the lost time by members of Congress dialing for dollars is a very serious problem. So it is in the minds of the people in this country that that our democracy is broken. In decisions that the U.S. Supreme Court has made, not just in Citizens United, but before and after, but the one that is most likely to have been heard about by most people is Citizens United. Those decisions have overturned 100 years of precedent law in this country. So that, I don't think, is any small matter. I mean, the courts generally, and I would guess lawyers, depend on precedential law and assume that there are decisions that decisions are being based on not just what the founding fathers thought at the time, but what legal case law has created in the history of this country. So Citizens United has opened the floodgates to more money and contributions in an unlimited way in our elections in this country. Montana's ban on corporate money was stricken down after Citizens United. Arizona's public financing, the legislature there decided that they needed to back down, and so their public financing law was weakened. And so it has had effects around the country. And the result is that unlimited money is flowing into campaigns at every level. This has resulted in the people in this country losing confidence in government, a level of cynicism that I don't think we have seen in the past, apathy in engaging in civic discourse, and in voting. I mean, I think the League of Women Voters is probably most, knowledgeable about how voting has decreased over the years, and especially most recently. I'm not sure what the turnout will be in our election that was just held on Tuesday, but by all accounts, it is going to be lower than ever, and lowest in those demographics that we are counting on to lead the way into the future and into the next decades. So, and I think, I think you can all likely think of more issues that arise because of the lack of being involved in the decisions that government makes and how we get back on track with making sure that people have confidence in government and in the public policy that's being made. People are waking up. It has not been that long since the Citizens United decision came about. And so far, 16 states have urged Congress to pass an amendment through resolutions from their state legislatures or letters that have been signed by a majority of legislators. And in the case of Montana and in Colorado, both of those states have passed ballot issues, not unlike what we're trying to do in Washington State. 600 cities and towns across the country have passed resolutions urging Congress to pass an amendment. Snohomish, Jefferson, and Island counties, and 13 municipalities in Washington have passed resolutions. Municipalities from Squim to Walla Walla, and including Seattle. And as you are likely aware, I know some of you are very aware because you are helping to gather signatures. WAmend is gathering signatures to get Initiative 735 on the ballot. Well, hopefully on the ballot. It is an initiative to the legislature, but assuming that the legislature will not pass it, but will pass it on to the people, it would be on the ballot in 2016. The Secretary of State's office, because of the Constitution, requires 247,000 valid signatures to be turned in by December 31st. And right now we have about 195,000. So we're doing, we still have almost 2 months to finish collecting. You know, we tried last year with Initiative 1329, and the volunteers did a great job and collected 175,000, but it was far short of the number needed. That was to be an initiative to the people, not to the legislature. This year we had a little longer time, and even though we're heading into bad weather, we think that this longer time has allowed us, with volunteers, to get 195,000 signatures. We expect to get more than the minimum with volunteers, and Fixed Democracy First is spearheading an effort to collect funds to pay signature gatherers to get that bump that you need for people who have signed twice or can't find their names on the voter registration and so on. So we feel like we have a good chance to make it this year. And I did pass out the petitions to everybody. I'd love to have you take them and get them filled out. I know that some of you may not feel like doing that, and especially I know because the League is doing their due diligence as usual to study whether a constitutional amendment is a way to go or not to figure out how to deal with the problem of the big money in elections. But I passed this out so that you could see the language that would be on the ballot title. The statement of the subject is it concerns a proposed amendment to the federal constitution. This measure would urge the Washington State Congressional Delegation to propose a federal constitutional amendment that constitutional rights belong only to individuals, not corporations, and constitutionally protected free speech excludes the spending of money. So this includes two of the two issues that most people have been concerned about with the Citizens United. The free speech, using money as speech, and corporations as people, as humans, basically, because it allows humans, it allows corporations the freedom of speech in elections, and there is no way for states or Congress to control that. So, and there is an explanation on the back, of course, the reasons why, what the findings are, and what will happen and why it's important to pass it. So this is what the signature gathering that is happening now with Initiative 735, and hoping to get it all the signatures in by December 31st, including about 50,000 signatures that will be paid for. That is a separate effort from the volunteer effort that WAmend is doing. As you know, you may be aware that we tried this last year with Initiative 1329, but not only with 1329, but we have been working on the legislature for several years for them to do a resolution. It is the sense of national organizations that are really concerned about this and are working on it, such as People for the American Way, Public Citizen, Common Cause. There are a number of national organizations that have been working on this issue. And we have been lobbying our legislature to pass a resolution so that we could avoid the expense and the time and the effort to get an initiative on the ballot. We have been unsuccessful. Recently as this last session, we had a letter that Public Citizen and Fixed Democracy First were circulating. We were not circulating it. Sharon Wiley in the House of Representatives and Pramila Jayapal in the Senate were circulating the letter for signatures. And it basically said, you know, that as a member of the legislature in Washington State, we are urging you to pass a constitutional amendment. And it says, apart from the court reversing itself, the only way to overturn the Supreme Court's ruling is to amend the U.S. Constitution to make clear the authority of Congress and state legislatures to regulate election spending consistent with our American ideals of equality and democracy. We, the undersigned members of the Washington State Legislature, call upon you to join your colleagues in the U.S. Senate and House of Representatives to send a constitutional amendment to the states reversing the United States Supreme Court's ruling in Citizens United versus Federal Elections Commission. Such an amendment should restore the right of the people's elected representatives to place reasonable limits on spending in elections and to make distinctions between the role of natural persons and artificial entities in our electoral process. So we lacked one signature from a senator. We had a majority signed in the House and lacking one for a majority in the Senate. And we worked hard to get that last signature, but couldn't quite make it. You should know, and if you've looked at your study guide, you do know that there have been a number of resolutions, House joint resolutions and Senate joint resolutions that have been introduced in the Congress. Three in the Senate and 10 in the House. The numbers that are in your study guide are not consistent with what was introduced in the 114th Congress. But you can find them. Senator Murray has sponsored one of them in the Senate, and all of our Democratic members of Congress have sponsored at least one of the House joint resolutions. So this should not be a partisan issue, and in fact, there are Republicans, and certainly with the polling, they're all over the map. But it is, I think, a moral issue for this country to not allow our democracy to be purchased by the money that goes into elections. And I think my time is up.
Thank you. So moving on to Janet Winans, our very own Janet Winans, co-chair of the League of Women Voters Washington Committee to study the impact of Citizens United versus Federal Election Commission. She's also second vice president of the League of Women Voters Seattle King County, program chair and chair of the League's Regional Transportation Committee. She's also a grandmother. Once, twice,
four.
So she's a busy woman.
A lot of credit for having grandchildren.
She earned her PhD in anthropology from the University of Washington, specializing in contemporary American adolescence, and wrote The Wasting of Dangerous Minds, Kids, Schools, Violence, and the Community. So let's give a warm welcome to Janet.
I decided myself to be the speaker tonight because someone has to explain to all of us, and I include myself in the us, what it is that the National League is asking us to do with this study that they have sent to us. This is going to be an opportunity for all of our units working with the consensus questions to begin the process of what will be writing a position for the National League of Women Voters about constitutional amount, amending the Constitution. When I began all of this work that I've been doing in these last 5 years, it was definitely stimulated by those things that Alice was talking about in terms of the decision by the Supreme Court. I think that that's one of the most important things that needs to be stated. It has a title, of course, but it was five members of the Supreme Court that made the decision that did declare that money equals speech, and that, however, it wasn't this particular Supreme Court that said that corporations are persons. One of the things that's just so very interesting about all of this process is how long in the making everything is. The place and time that corporations became people by 1886, lawyers successfully used the 14th Amendment to argue that corporations have the rights afforded to persons. Specifically, the Southern Pacific Railroad claimed to have the same tax exemptions that persons of California have. In spite of the fact that the California State Constitution denied railroads the right to deduct the amount of their debts, meaning mortgages, from the taxable value of their property, a right which was given to individuals. The text of the Supreme Court's decision includes, one of the points made and discussed at length in the brief of counsel was that corporations are persons within the meaning of the 14th Amendment to the Constitution of the United States. Before the court began to hear the arguments of opposing counsel, Chief Justice Waite said, "The court does not wish to hear argument on the question whether the provision in the 14th Amendment to the Constitution, which forbids a state to deny any person within its jurisdiction the equal protection of the laws, applies to these corporations. We are of the opinion that it does." It was the court's clerk who chose the following words as the heading of the record of the court's proceedings. "The defendant corporations are persons within the intent of the clause in Section 1 of the 14th Amendment of the Constitution of the United States." So as we're talking about these things, it's really important to try to consider how we as citizens can rally ourselves as these issues come forward. Many, many of us who were and are members of the League of Women Voters had assumed that the Citizens United decision would stimulate a very significant interaction from the National League of Women Voters, that we would add our voices to those that Alice talked about. And the National said to us, "We have no position on amending the Constitution." It was very confusing to have that be the answer to how we wanted to engage the question. It wasn't like we were engaging the answer. We wanted to engage the question, but the League has followed through with things like amicus briefs for every succeeding decision or case that has been brought before the Supreme Court since 2010. So as when the Montana anti-corruption law was struck down, we have tried to defend those, we try to hang on to those already established precedents each time using the legal means that is the tool that the League uses. At this point in time, the League, well, in 2014 convention, the League authorized this study of amending the Constitution, the study of money and politics, which we had discussed in our last month's program, and also to work to build concurrence among state leagues to establish an actual national position on redistricting. So those are the methods that the League is using to again rally our forces in these issues. The more I have been studying this night's issues, the more I've come to understand that the League is coming from a position of really being disturbed by some of those proposals for constitutional amendments that would not be things that we valued. And I, as I was preparing for tonight, I found a quotation that just really seemed, it triggered my ability to write what I was going to try to say tonight. Mary Frances Berry was the Geraldine R. Siegel Professor of American Social Thought at the University of Pennsylvania and a member of the United States Commission on Civil Rights when she wrote this statement in an article in the New York Times Magazine, September 13, 1987. These are not new issues. The very difficulty of amending the Constitution greatly increases the importance of Supreme Court decisions interpreting the Constitution, because reversal of a court's decision by amendment is unlikely except in cases when the public's disagreement is intense and close to unanimous. Even unpopular court decisions are likely to stand unless the court itself changes its collective mind. This month, we are going to be dealing with the consensus questions from which the National Committee, the Study Committee, will produce the position that we will then discuss and ratify at our 2016 convention. The consensus questions seem to take both sides of this issue. The danger that a rampant Congress could propose a really harmful amendment, such as illustrated by an amendment declaring marriage to be one man and one woman. It sounds like such a simple idea, doesn't it? And establish in that final document end all argument. A different idea is that in 1970, 71, 72, the state of Washington did pass a constitutional amendment allowing abortion. And as a result, we've had a bulwark against forces We've had a bulwark. That's one of the ways to look at it. Others have found that a very great impediment toward how they would like to have that subject dealt with. So as you go through these consensus questions, please consider, one, it is very important to have this tool for amending the Constitution. The kinds of amendments that Paul talked about, the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments, followed war. And they dealt with a really important issue that had been written into the Constitution. The Constitution had declared that slavery, well, the Constitution just took for granted that slavery was an institution of the United States, and they declared in the Constitution that slaves equaled 3/4 of a person in order to enhance the census of those states who had slaves to count. It took a war. It took how many years from the time of the writing of the Constitution and the Bill of Rights, and a war to change that assumption held firmly in our Constitution. It's important that we have the opportunity to do that. You could even say it took a war to lower the voting age to 18. That was a result of the war in Vietnam. Finally, people decided that perhaps if they can go to war and get killed, they should get to vote about whether or not we elect people who will send us to war, because that we're a representative government. We elect people to represent us. I think Alice is talking about how do we rally ourselves to elect people to represent us, and how do we use the various tools. So it is extremely important to remember that we have the tool of amending the Constitution. It is extremely important to remember so does everyone else. So the League wants us to answer particular questions as we're thinking about these issues of amending the Constitution. Does the public policy objective address matters of such acute and abiding importance that the fundamental charter of our nation must be changed? Is the amendment as written, would the amendment as written be effective in achieving its policy objective? Will the amendment either make our political system more democratic or protect individual rights? Will the policy objective, can it be achieved by a legislative or political approach that is less difficult than a constitutional amendment? And I think that that's one of our huge questions in dealing with the collective mind of our current Supreme Court. And whether the public policy objective is more suited to a constitutional and general approach than to a statutory and detailed approach. Because, of course, a constitutional amendment is very few words. The statutes that then go to be used to interpret those few words are many, many, many words. So that's enough for me, and I'd like to make questions available. If you have questions to any of us about any of the things that we've talked about, including how you will deal with your consensus questions in your units, we are available to try to answer them.
Do we have questions from the audience? Yes, we do. Look at that. Do we have anybody to collect? So to start with, I had a question for you. Oh, for you, Paul. And maybe let me just get started, I guess. But what are some of the things we should be concerned about if we proceed with a constitutional amendment as proposed to fix the Citizens United decision?
First of all, let me say clearly, I think Citizen United was wrongly decided. Unfortunately, five members of the Supreme Court disagreed. The concerns that one should have in thinking about where to draw these lines is what does it mean outside of this context? In other words, Citizens United is a rallying point that I think probably everybody in the room could agree is a danger to democracy. The tougher question is, if you pursue a constitutional amendment on this issue, are you giving a roadmap or making it easier for other people to pursue other constitutional amendments on like issues where they disagree with the U.S. Supreme Court decision? Are you setting some sort of precedent or roadmap to others who might pursue constitutional amendments that would be contrary, for example, to league policy? And you know, that is the danger that you're facing. It certainly may be that this is so fundamental an issue. Yes, this is worthy of a constitutional amendment. There are efforts being made, like out of Seattle, the election reform here in Seattle. There are efforts being made to reform election laws nationwide that can undo some of the damage. There's the potential that Supreme Court people on the Supreme Court will change over the next 15 years, in which case that decision may be overturned. It has happened before. Is this the question? Certainly there are times when constitutional amendments are appropriate. So the question is, how do you draw that line, and where do you draw that line, and what are the consequences of how you draw that line? And I think that's what you have to be careful about.
Thank you. And a question for you, Alice, and it kind of goes along that line. This is not the first time we've lost our democracy to big money. If Citizens United is overturned by changing the makeup of the Supreme Court, what are your thoughts about continuing to strive to have an amendment limiting or controlling campaign financing?
Well, if it were overturned, then, there wouldn't be the need to overturn Citizens United. But the people who are most likely to go off of the Supreme Court are the ones who were in the minority on the decisions, both the McCutcheon decision and on the Citizens United decision. So there may still be a need for returning some sanity to controlling expenditures and contributions in elections. Independent expenditures and super PACs were let loose in the Vallejo decision, which happened before Citizens United. So it's not just Citizens United, it's some other decisions that the court has made as well.
Thank you. Thanks. So this is for Paul. What are the pros and cons of Supreme Court justices being appointed for life? And when they lean one way or the other and legislate from the bench, how can they protect our democracy for us all?
Well, the pros of a life appointment is that theoretically you are immune to political pressure. The cons for life appointment is that you're there for life, and that can be good or bad. I think that if you contrast the Supreme Court of the United States, the Supreme Court of Washington, Washington has an elected court. I certainly have seen evidence in Washington state that there are decisions made with political consequences in mind. So to say that life tenure is not something that's important to independence, I think, is unrealistic. On the other hand, Justice Roberts' description of a justice as somebody who's just calling balls or strikes neutrally is, in my mind, inaccurate. People may have a high strike zone or a low strike zone, a conservative strike zone or a liberal strike zone, and I think we need to be informed as citizens about those tendencies in advance of somebody being approved by the Senate. And it works both ways. That's a short anecdote because I don't want to get on. I was on a plane with a New Hampshire Supreme Court justice when Souter was nominated by the Republicans to be on the state Supreme Court. He told me, the Republicans have no idea what they've done. And he was right.
Janet, considering all the history of amendments, including the 19th, of course, why doesn't the U.S. League already have a position on constitutional amendments? Did the U.S. League not support the ERA?
Ha. That, of course, is was flabbergasting to me. Yes, do we not have a position on amending the Constitution? We are voting because of an amendment to the Constitution, and it was not easy to cause that to happen. It took a very long time to gather all of the energies that it took to finally pass it. One of the things that I discovered as I was reading, preparing for tonight, was I thought, but what about white male suffrage? Because that's something that I know is a part of the ever more representative government that we have. So I looked up white male suffrage, because I know there is no amendment for white male suffrage. And the article told me that it was the result of the political turmoil that resulted as the War of 1812 was brewing, and they needed soldiers, and the political parties were forming and were arguing with each other, and they needed voters. And so it seemed like a good way to get more voters was to add white men to the voting rolls. What I did not know until I read this article was that because white property owners were the voters, there actually were white women property owners who were voters. They were disenfranchised at the time that universal white male suffrage was instituted. So as we look at some of these issues, you know, the kind of thing of when do you want to have something fundamental be a part of what our constitutional structure is, and the League says we have to have a position before we can enter into the conversation with all of these other groups. And I think that prior to Citizens United, one of the things that I've thought about Citizens United is that it was a great gift, because as Alice said, we've had the money in politics since the Buckley decision. It was years and years ago. Citizens United just showed us it all in full glory. So I think that's when the League then began to say, hey, wait a minute, now we're confronted with this. It was easy when we had issues that there was no way that we were going to want to participate in flag-burning amendments. On the other hand, now, if we have something that we really do want to participate in, it's time for us to have formulated how we're going to do that.
Thank you. And to Paul, what methods other than constitutional amendment are there to change the effects, I guess, of Citizens United decision, if any?
Well, I think a number have been mentioned. I mean, obviously there's the opportunity for the Supreme Court to reverse its decision. As has been pointed out, some of the younger members of the court are people who are in the majority, and that is a process that will take time. It's not impossible. There are certainly some steps that are being considered and starting being taken in terms of how to change the financing of elections to move towards more public financing of elections that on a voluntary basis can encourage candidates not to accept certain monies and maybe disassociate themselves, though it doesn't really address the independent financial expenditures. I think the main thing that people talk about are disclosure laws that really try to make the money, who's behind an independent exposure, visible. Right now, there's a set of entities that are protected by federal statute from having to disclose who they are. So I think the main thing that one could work at more immediately would be strengthening the public disclosure law so that who is funding particular ads, particular advocacy can be disclosed.
Thank you. And Alice, and I think I'm just going to add something to this question, just to preface it. But first of all, the plan, what is the plan? Is it a constitutional convention that you're trying to get, or is it something else? And then what tools do we have to keep it on track once it's out of our hands?
Well, I'm not sure about the tools. I mean, the tools then would be a part of the legislative body's responsibilities, the state legislatures, if they are included in the amendment, and the Congress. We are not in favor of a constitutional convention. I noticed in the study guide that the League has put together that there are a number of questions around holding a constitutional convention. But for fixed democracy first is not in favor of a constitutional convention. We have been approached by Wolfpack, which is the national organization that is advocating a constitutional convention, and they have quite an active group in this state that approached the legislature with a resolution. If it had passed, it would be urging our members of Congress to support calling a constitutional convention as a means of amending the U.S. Constitution. Our reason for not supporting it is that there really isn't anything in the U.S. Constitution that in any way regulates what can happen at a constitutional convention. It would all depend on how the delegates are selected and who shows up and what they want to change. And we just weren't for that. And so this 735 is advocating an amendment and not a constitutional convention.
Okay, thank you. Someone wants to know, can you sign I-735 online?
No, okay. You can't sign it online. It is a legal, the petitions are legal documents, and you can only sign a petition that is being circulated in hand. And there are a lot of people who think that they have signed the petition because they did sign something online. There are a number of organizations that are sending out emails that ask people to sign a petition for whatever, to overturn Citizens United. But that is not a legal document, and at this point, our state doesn't allow you to turn in online petitions.
And I think I'll ask you this, Paul, and I think hopefully you can explain how equality under the law, well, I guess maybe how the Equal Protection Clause would protect corporate speech. Because the questioner is saying, isn't this really essentially setting up a class system whereby people who can pay get the laws passed that they want? So how is that equal protection under the laws?
So you start with the question of, as was described, what is a person, right? And the 14th Amendment protects persons. Unfortunately, there has been some, there was some statutory history, and this was relied upon in Citizens United, that defines persons as including corporations or corporate entities, because I think in the original construct before the 1890s, when corporations really kind of grew as an entity, they really were more a gathering of individuals just to do a business. There wasn't a sense of a large corporate structure. So what has happened, unfortunately, is the blurring of a line between a person who has rights and what a corporation is. So yes, you're right. It makes no sense to me. It makes no sense if you look at the history of the 14th Amendment to think that it was concerned about people, corporations as people, as opposed to people as people. But that's where it comes from. And again, it doesn't make any sense to me as a matter of what the equal protection of laws was trying to encompass, to say that it requires a corporation to be treated equally to a former slave in terms of their rights being asserted. But that's what the court held.
Okay.
Can I add something to that?
Yes.
Jim Street, who I'm sure some of you know, who is a judge and has been active on this issue, did some analysis of the Citizens United decision, and it's his analysis that says, in the case of political free speech, the Supreme Court defines the issue as not one of the individual's personal right, but rather one of the public's right to unfettered access to speech. Therefore, then a corporation or anybody that has money to get their word out there should be unfettered. The free market of ideas, so to speak, no weight was given by the court to the principle of government by the people, and little remaining weight is given to concerns about the appearance of corruption. Jim Street's analysis.
I said this last month as I was talking about my reading of the documents. It really hit me as I was preparing for last month's forum, that what the Supreme Court freed was the right to spend. And I think that it's just flabbergasting to think about that, that they said it is a violation of a person's constitutional rights to limit how much they choose to spend. Expenditures is the word that the decision uses, and you can see that. Oh, and it's also it limits a person's right to expenditure if you do something, if government intercedes and does something to balance the expendituring by an opponent of someone who is expendituring. So that, and what they actually said in the decision was, that's a violation. I mean, what you're saying, if you say to a candidate who wants to expenditure his resources to his heart's content, that your opponent can also now, we will assist your opponent to have more money to expenditure along beside you. What that means is the person already expendituring is going to just have to expenditure more. And that what that really means is that he's contributing to his opponent's ability to spend money. So, I mean, it said that in the document. I mean, not with my voice, of course.
Okay, thank you, Janet. Just a couple more, I think, hopefully quick. Please clarify what happens if someone accidentally signs twice on Initiative 735, or any initiative for that matter. Do they get arrested?
No.
No. It's not considered a felony, not even a misdemeanor. What happens is when the Secretary of State's office checks the signatures, they will count one and not the others, whether it's one, two, or three, or more others. If you think you might have signed once and then you've forgotten when you did it, and you sign twice, they'll just strike the one, and they expect that happens. So that's why they say, consider that you need more signatures for the error rate. And so that's why we need 310 to 320,000 instead of the 247,000.
And Janet, just a clarification on what the members are supposed to be doing on this consensus. So the purpose of the league study to reach consensus is the purpose, I guess. Is this the best way to amend the Constitution, or to develop a tool to decide what constitutional amendments to support? Did I make that make sense at all? I guess I don't understand what outcome will result from this study.
I think it's a very excellent question, and making sense is one of the things that's going to be a part of your unit meetings. This is my personal reading. My reading is that we are going to be able to answer the consensus questions about coming from a position of our own values as league members. And by answering the specific questions that they've sent us from that position of our values, they will begin to understand how to write a position that will be national and exist in the time of forever, as opposed to be particular in terms of this time or this issue. So that's why I read those questions about what will an amendment do. We need to have a position that incorporates the position. I mean, if we were to have a position to amend the Constitution, the first question that would be asked about the language of the amendment was, does it fit with the rest of our positions? I mean, if it doesn't, then we're not going to go any further, no matter what our position on amending the Constitution is. But on the other hand, if we come to consensus that we're not going to participate in the amendment process, that's what our position would be. So freedom to participate in a process that is constitutionally provided to us seems to be something that I'm hoping the League position will include. It would be terrible if the League took a position and denied us our constitutional rights. But it's almost like magic to me. Those consensus questions are very confusing, and I just think we should go at them with our best efforts and our best intentions, because they're so confusing. It's sort of like the Ouija board. I can't tell what they hope they're gonna get the answer, So okay. Go for it.
Okay, but it's not specifically for this particular issue, it's whether in general we're going to support or not.
Whether in general we support the constitutional provision 5.
Whether or not we're going to support, yeah, okay, that is kind of crazy. Okay.
It's for my 2 cents worth. I mean, you have to support the right to amend the Constitution at times. I think there are times it's clear, such as the amendment for equal voting rights for women, where rights are being denied, and you need to step up, you need to have the ability as an organization to step up and say, yes, the tougher question is where you draw the line. I'm not sure that the League wants you or requires you to draw a line, but I think you need to think about that question as well, but the question whether or not the league, at certain circumstances, maybe not for all the league policies, but certainly for some league policies, it seems like you should support the constitutional amendment process.
Thank you.
I agree.
Yes, thank you. Thank you for coming. Thank you all for a wonderful presentation. And oh, I think, wait, you can't leave yet because Amanda's going to come up and talk to you some more. Briefly, she says.
Well, I want to thank the panelists, too, for an absolutely fascinating evening. And I do have, yeah, okay. Yeah. And I do have just a couple of announcements. This has been filmed and will be available on King County TV. That's channel 22, at least on most of our systems, I think. And also on the back of your program, there's a little bit more information about the legislative action workshop, which I really do encourage you to try to come to that. So thank you all for coming very much. And I think we'll see you in January. So thanks a lot.
If you are interested in collecting some signatures, even if it's just your own or your family's, that would be great. And the place to send it back is on the back of it. If not, just put them back up here, and I will take them home. And some of you I know are collecting, so you probably have your own.